skyline and really the city, if not the world. Back to you.
All right, Mr. Hoffer, thank you. The questions that you raised, needless to say, will be answered in the days and weeks and months.
Absolutely. And I have to ask Jim here, Jim having covered the 1993 bombing of the World Trade Center. Jim, the investigation on that, how did it progress? How will this investigation progress?
Well, keep in mind the World Trade Center explosion was... The explosion was confined to a very small area. In terms of forensic evidence, it was actually pretty easy to solve. They found the one truck inside that World Trade Center that exploded from within and not from without. They traced that truck back to the people who had rented the truck. You'll remember it was a Ryder van. They traced it back to them. It was pretty easy to find out the people who planted that bomb. This is a much different situation. Obviously, the Taliban today saying Osama bin Laden doesn't have the resources to pull something major like this off. But if Osama bin Laden doesn't, who does? Someone certainly pulled it off today.
And there had to have been amazing resources to pull this off. You're talking about a number of planes hijacked. There had to have been resources within the airports. There had to have...
Hijacked and then flown to their targets. Remember, the pilots who were originally on board those aircrafts weren't the ones who flew them into the World Trade Center. Someone with sophistication and know-how how to pilot those aircrafts had to fly them into the towers and then, of course, also into the Pentagon.
Mm-hmm. A suicide flyer, obviously. We're joined also in the studio this morning, or this afternoon, rather, by Bill Heitman, who was in one of the towers when this happened. And, Bill, after hearing Jim Hoffer and seeing him running from the scene there as the building collapsed, I was wondering, as you were trying to get out, you were in the darkened stairwell for an hour, did it ever cross your mind that the building might collapse?
Absolutely not. As a matter of fact, there was good spirit in the stairwell. I can honestly say we were having some laughs, you know. We were just getting down, making the best of it. Some people had to. It was more urgent for them to get down, so we would all call out, move to the right, and they would proceed down. But there was no panic, and there was generally, considering the circumstances, good spirit in the stairwell.
Again, as you said earlier, it didn't seem to be as bad as the other explosion, the first explosion.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not.
So no clue, and no panic as you were going down.
No panic. The thought of the building collapsing or being in any more danger never crossed my mind.
And then, Bill, you said it wasn't... Sorry?
Jim, I'm sorry to interrupt because I want to just point out in this live picture here, what you're looking at is damage to an adjoining building. Obviously, the impact of this, not just to those twin towers, but also to adjoining buildings. And it looks like there is still, obviously, smoke, and I think I saw some flames there as well, Jim. So clearly there is still damage.
And they're all bunched up so closely together down there, obviously, mm-hmm. and there was bound to be collateral damage in the neighboring businesses.
Absolutely. Bill, as you were going down that darkened stairwell, and you say you had no thought that the building might collapse, was that because you had faith in the integrity of the building or simply because you did not know what was going on?
I had no idea the magnitude of the crash above us. We didn't know that there were we didn't know anything had happened over in two. We thought it was just us in one. And as the further we got down, it was just flooded. It was and emergency personnel were very, very urgently trying to get us out of the building. And I
so
myself.
So were people milling around down there trying to check on others in the building?
No,
or were
as
they
soon as you came out of the
out.
Stairwell, there was great urgency. Just personnel, go that way, get out. And everybody was just walking through water.
Sir, can I ask you to stand by for just a moment? Mary Johnson on the phone. She is with the New York Hospital Association, and this is the theme that you are going to hear.
1725 Forest Avenue. In Long Island, there are four locations. 2500 Marcus Avenue in Lake Success, 125 Veterans Highway in Bohemia, 333 Merrick Road in Rockville Center, and Route 10 Huntington. In Westchester, there's a donation site at 525 Executive Boulevard in Elmsford, and in New Jersey at 167 New Street in New Brunswick. And also, I want to...
I saw originally coming out the window, and I was, at that time, I was quite upset about it, that I thought we should get in there. But then the explosion on the south World Trade happened, and I said, this is something we have to do, we have to back out. We backed out over here, and even then, that's when I was caught again in the second explosion.
I went up to the elevator, the 24th floor, as soon as we get up there, the elevator get out. I got power, we lost power in the elevator. Thank God we kept one of the truck guys there, and he forced the door, and then we worked our way down the stairs. As we came down the stairs, we were just dragging people along with us, and then when we came outside, it just blew, the tower blew, and I found a mask on the floor as I was crawling.
Amazing sound from a firefighter who was on the scene. We have been on the air now for several hours since 9 o'clock this morning covering this event, and we obviously still do not know the extent of the injuries, of the casualties. We can only guess that they are quite massive, and I know there is great relief to those who see any family, any friends on our air who are okay. And as we can get information about numbers to call, about what you can do, we will be bringing that information to you as quickly as possible. You're looking at a live picture from Newscopter 7 right now, and of course you can see that there is fire in adjacent buildings. There is problems, serious problems still in that area down in Lower Manhattan.
A story that just crossed the wire and one we haven't talked about in the last hour or so. International airlines had to scramble to divert or cancel flights going to the United States. Undoubtedly, there are people in our audience today who were going to JFK Airport to pick up friends, loved ones, business associates, and those people couldn't land here. A couple of hours ago, Canada said, if you like, you can use any and all of our airports here because we feel that they are safe. The cancellations and diversions caused confusion and congestion, not only at airports in this country, but at many European airlines, where airlines ordered flights bound for the United States to do U-turns or to find alternative landing points outside of America. Mm-hmm. Some airlines reversed course only after being denied permission to land by the FAA, which ordered the U.S. airspace, and this is all across the country, they sterilized the airspace over the entire United States. European airlines, American airlines, sorting out how they're going to get these people home. All I can tell the folks at home is that as we go throughout this day, we will be efforting information to find out about the people on those planes, where they are, whether they're in Canada, which planes were diverted back to their original points of origin. As we get information on this, we will share it with you.
Absolutely. We have Celeste Ford, who is at JFK right now for us. Celeste, give us an idea of what's going on there right now.
We're told that all nationwide is still suspended.